Hey, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Oasis Church. I'm Pastor Bob, and I'm going to be leading us this morning as we continue in our series called Greatest Hits, Volume 7 this morning. One more week, and then we'll be moving back to our series in 1 John. Now, today, there's not going to be a long intro, no trivia questions, no videos for us to watch. We're just going to jump right into it because we have a lot to cover this morning. I want to start this morning by giving you a difficult question for you to think about. Have you ever felt like giving up? I know people don't want to, I know you don't want to admit that, but have you, maybe 2020 has kind of pushed you farther than you've ever wanted to be towards the edge of, you know what, this just isn't worth it. Maybe you're in one of the biggest storms of your life right now, and it's catching up with you. And you know that you're kind of swimming in over your head. Well, this morning we're going to talk about a prophet named Jeremiah. He can teach us a lot about discouragement. He can teach us a lot about wanting to give up, but keep on keeping on. You know, I'm going to speak from personal experience this morning. Over the last several months, I've almost felt like, you know, stopping a lot of things that I like to do, giving up. I mean, wouldn't it be just cool somewhere to go to wherever you could go and all of this mess that we're in would be over and it would be just peaceful? Man, I look forward to that, but I'm going to tell you something. We can't give up. And there's been two verses that have really kind of ministered to me during these times. And I want to share those two with you. These are two verses that mean a lot to me when I feel like giving up. And the first one's found in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. It says, "Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary." I wonder how many of us out here are starting to feel a little weary, ready to kind of just pack it in, okay, and waiting for Jesus to come back or whatever else may happen. We can't grow weary. We've got to keep on going for the sake of his kingdom. The second verse I was thinking about is from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. And it says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil," or knowing that your work, "is not in vain in the Lord." So maybe it's some type of project you've got going that, you know what, you're ready to quit, okay? It's too hard. Maybe it's a relationship, okay? And things aren't going the way you think or the way you would like them to go. Maybe it's your relationship with God. Maybe somehow you feel that God has disappointed you or God hasn't shown up real big in your life as of recently. Maybe it's your job. You know what? I am just sick of my job and I don't want to do it anymore. I get it, okay? It's been a tough year. You've had all that you can take and you can't take anymore. I know Jeremiah, the prophet, now, not the bullfrog, the prophet is going to speak loud and clear to us this morning. So my goal this morning, as we kind of begin to look at the life of Jeremiah, is to worship and praise God. That's number one. And secondly, I pray that the Holy Spirit will say something to you this morning, okay, that will help you and encourage you if you're getting to that point where you feel like quitting. Now, Jeremiah is an Old Testament guy. Okay, and we're going to kind of catch up on his story. So I got to give you a little bit of a brief background of what's happening during the time of Jeremiah. And in order to do that, I'm going to go all the way back to Genesis 12. Okay, Genesis 12 is where Abraham is promised by God, okay, that he would make him the father of many nations and specifically one nation called Israel. Now, Abraham has some sons named Isaac and Jacob. And they lived there in some tents for a couple hundred years waiting for this new land. And during that time, there's a famine and Jacob decides to move his family to Egypt. Now, this is a providential move because when he does this, one of his sons, Joseph, becomes second in command in charge of all of Egypt. Now, God's people live in Egypt for about, you know, several years, but then the Egyptians take them as slaves. And they're slaves for approximately 400 years. Then the guy you've probably heard around comes around, Moses, and he delivers the people from slavery. They walk through the parted Red Sea. They camp on the east side of this promised land that God wants them to take possession of. The problem, the glitch in the plan, is that the people had no faith. And God caused them to wander around the desert for 40 years. Now, Moses is about ready to die. Okay, and when he gets ready to die, he has some pretty strong words for the nation of Israel as they get ready to go in and conquer this promised land. He basically goes on to say that you have the choice, okay, you have the choice between prosperity and disaster, between life and death. And if they would just love the Lord and keep his commands, everything would turn out okay. If you do this, God will bless you, and everything and everyone will live happily ever after. But if your heart turns away from God, and if you worship other gods, Moses warned them that you will certainly be destroyed. Now, this is important, and you will not live the good life that God had for you in the area that he chose for the Israelites to live in. Moses tells them, you have the choice between life and death, blessings and curses. And you know what they're going to pick, right? They're not going to pick blessings and life. They're going to pick the other side. Anyway, Moses dies. Joshua assumes control of the land, and he goes on to conquer this promised land over the next 27 years. Eventually, they would have a king. His name would be Saul. And everything starts out really, really good for Saul and ends up really, really bad. And David becomes the new king of Israel. David dies. Solomon comes along and builds the temple for God. When Solomon dies, his son, Rehoboam, becomes the new king. And this is where everything starts to go south. This is where it all begins to fall apart for the nation of Israel. Right after Rehoboam becomes king, a bunch of people come into Jerusalem from the north. They're led by a guy named Jeroboam. And these people come to the new king and tell him, we need tax cuts because your father's taxes are killing us. Well, Rehoboam has some bad news for them. And he says, basically, stop your whining, okay, because the taxes are going to go up. And you kind of thought we were the only ones today that were battling with taxes. And this really ticks the people off. And they start their own nation. Basically, a civil war begins between the north and the south. Brother fighting brother. Let me tell you, brother fighting brother is never a good thing. Oh, the lessons we could learn if we would just learn to read our Bible. And now, since the people in the north no longer have a temple, they turn away from God. And what happens is their rebellion is so bad in the year 722, the Assyrians come along and they utterly destroy the northern kingdom. Matter of fact, it's a pretty ugly sight. They tried also, the Assyrians tried to take the southern kingdom as well, but God rescues them. So here you have it. The northern kingdom is gone because they turn away from God. And you would think that the southern kingdom would learn the lessons of the north and really repent and turn back to God. You would think that, right? They didn't. They chose to worship other gods. And it was during this time, this total, if you want to call it, mess of a world, that Jeremiah is born and his ministry begins. And let me tell you something. He has a tough ministry ahead of him. And as he begins his ministry, it's not going to be a cakewalk. It's going to be extremely difficult, extremely hard. And I'm going to tell you right now, Jeremiah wants to quit. So let's look at some of the reasons why Jeremiah wanted to quit. The first one probably won't catch you by any surprise at all. It's called people, okay? I mean, has there ever been a time in your life where people have made you want to quit? Well, you would have hoped that the southern kingdom would have learned their lessons. They would have watched what happened to the north. But the people are stubborn, and the people want to do their own thing. Matter of fact, I want you to hear what God says about the people. Okay, the people in Judah, and this comes from chapter 3, verse 10. And let me just read it to you. It says, "And I saw that for all the adulteries of faithless Israel, and I had sent her away and given her a writ of divorce. Yet her treacherous sister Judah did not fear, but she went and was a harlot also." They didn't learn the lessons. They went and repeated the same lessons. Now, pick up in verse 9 with me. "Because of the lightness of her harlotry, she polluted the land and committed idolatry with stones and trees. Yet in spite of all of this treacherous sister, Judah did not return to me." Judah did not return to God. "And with all of our heart, but rather in deception, declares the Lord." Now, let me just kind of give you what happened here. They watched Israel get destroyed by Assyria. They did not repent. And they continued to go in the wrong direction and pretended, okay, this is what's interesting, they pretended to be in a right relationship with God. And God calls them out on this. Now, Jeremiah tells them that you can steal, you can commit adultery, you can lie, you can worship Baal, you can serve those false gods, but you cannot come in here and stand in the temple and chant that we are safe and that we love God and that we praise God. I'm going to tell you something. These people are sick, okay? They're kind of doing what's right in their own heart and then pretending that everything is okay between them and God. So the people really discouraged Jeremiah during that time. Now, there was a second reason that Jeremiah found it, you know, probably easy to quit, but he didn't. Because following God is tough. Let me say that again, because it's true today. If you're going to follow God and you're going to be used by Him, it's tough. It's going to be hard. So Jeremiah had a difficult message to preach, and no one wanted to hear it. Jeremiah's message was not a popular message by any means. His message is that God was angry, he was going to seek justice, and he was going to unleash his fury on the people because of their sin. Jeremiah wasn't the only prophet, let me tell you, okay? There were lots of other prophets out there, and the people despised the prophets because they spoke the word of God. Sometimes your ministry is tough, and the people are in between like a hard, you know, a hard spot right now because they can be judged by God. And in this point, or they can be captured by the Babylonians. One of the two is going to happen. And they ended up being taken captive by the Babylonians. And their cities were burned. A temple was destroyed. And the people were held captive. But I want you to hear Jeremiah's heart. He still has a burden for the people. He says, "As for prophets, my heart is broken within me. And all my bones tremble. I have become like a drunken man, even like a man overcome with wine, because of the Lord and because of his holy words." Jeremiah had a reputation. He was the prophet of doom and gloom. He was known as the weeping prophet, the prophet of death and destruction. And this was the mission that God had for him. You might be sitting there right now saying, that's a pretty tough mission. But let me tell you something. God has a mission for you too. Hang on to that. Now, there's another reason why, you know, Jeremiah might have wanted to throw in the towel. It's called rejection and futility. Now, keep this in mind. Jeremiah preached for 40 plus years and no one would listen to him. No one would change their life and stop doing the evil that they were doing before God. How would you like to preach the same message for 40 plus years? The message of death and destruction and judgment. Yep, that's what Jeremiah did. And the people would have nothing to do with him. Jeremiah was also, let's just say this, he was one lonely guy. You might think that, you know, after the end of the night, you know, Jeremiah would go home to his loving wife and he would just have this conversation with Jeremiah and everything would be better. But God told Jeremiah that he couldn't even marry a woman. God told Jeremiah that he did not want him to go into the, if let's just say, the social events or the parties of the day, because God was getting ready to judge. Ministry sometimes, and sometimes you can be very lonely, okay, because of what God has asked you to do. Now, the other one is called hardship, okay? I don't know whether you know this about Jeremiah, but people plotted against, okay, Jeremiah. He was put on trial for his life. I mean, the first draft of his message and his words actually got burned by the king. He was arrested and accused of treason. He was dumped into a well and almost drowned in mud. That's the life of Jeremiah. And Jeremiah, you know, had every reason to throw in the towel. I mean, talk about discouragement. Talk about being to the edge of, you know, nowhere, no return. This is Jeremiah. But I want you to know something. Jeremiah wasn't perfect by any means. Let's just say this. He hated his own life sometimes. He would ask questions that, like questions that you and I would ask. And maybe we're even asking today, where's God in all of this? Why is God allowing all this suffering? Why can't there be a cure for this or a cure for that? And Jeremiah wears his emotions on his sleeve, okay? He goes on to say, and I like this, he says, I'm just going to curse the day that I was born. I don't want anyone to celebrate the day of my birth. Matter of fact, I want to curse the messenger. This is what Jeremiah is saying. I want to curse the messenger that told my dad, I have good news for you. You have a son. I mean, Jeremiah is having a pretty big, let's just say it, pity party. Now, I want you to know Jeremiah is one of those people in life that was just not having a good time. Okay? Jeremiah was hanging on. And I'm sure that there are a lot of days that he woke up and he just felt like, you know what, I'm just going to stay in bed today. So why didn't Jeremiah give up? And honestly, why shouldn't we give up? Here's the answer. Jeremiah, first of all, he had a God-given purpose. Now, I like Rick Warren, and I've read a few of his books, and one of those books was called A Purpose-Driven Life, and I know many of you have read it, but I just want to read this section about purpose that Rick Warren says. Nothing matters more than knowing God's purpose for your life. Let me say that one more time. There's nothing that matters more, okay, than knowing what God's purpose for your life is. And I should say purposes, because it's just not a single purpose. There are purposes that God has in store for us. And now this is what Rick Warren says, okay? This isn't me, this is Rick. Blame Rick, okay? He says, and nothing can compensate for not knowing God's purpose. Not success, not wealth, not fame or pleasure. He says, without purpose, life is motion without meaning. It's activity without direction. Now this is Rick Warren. And he says, it's events without reason. He says, without purpose, life is trivial. It's petty. It's pointless. And when life has meaning, you can almost bear anything. But without meaning, man, is it tough. See, Jeremiah had a purpose. Matter of fact, God told him that he had a purpose for him in the very first chapter of it. He told Jeremiah, he says, I formed you in your mother's womb. This is God speaking to Jeremiah. I formed you in your mother's womb, and I set you apart, and I appointed you to be my spokesman. There's Jeremiah's purpose. God says, I created you. I knew you in your mom's womb, and therefore, don't tell me you can't do something. I've given you the purpose, I've equipped you for the purpose, and I'm going to allow you to do your purpose through me. This is what he's telling Jeremiah. Jeremiah also had something to anchor to, and it was called hope. Let me tell you something. Jeremiah had hope that one day God was going to rescue him, and he was going to rescue the people in Israel. Matter of fact, Jeremiah's hope, okay, is a Bible verse that all of us like to talk about. It's the one that talks about that God says that he has a plan for Jeremiah, a plan to prosper him and to not harm him, and plan to give him what? Hope and a future. See, Jeremiah knew that there was going to be battles and war and famine and sin and destruction. Jeremiah knew that God had a plan for him and that God was going to give him hope and that his plan was not to harm him. See, a lot of times we think that God is punishing us for something that we've done wrong. And maybe even Jeremiah might have thought that at that point. But God was disciplining. And he disciplined Jeremiah. He disciplines you and I. And he disciplines us so that we'll grow in our relationship with him. Now, the last thing that Jeremiah had, okay, before I talk to you directly, all right, is he had a mighty God to trust in. It was Jeremiah who said, "O sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power. Nothing is too hard for you." What a mighty God Jeremiah served. A great and powerful God is what Jeremiah said, whose name is the Lord Almighty. And your purposes are mighty and your dealings are great. That's Jeremiah praising God for being a mighty God. See, Jeremiah knew that God created everything. He made the heavens and the earth, and that he could deliver his people. And everything that God said that he had done in the past, Jeremiah knew was going to happen in the future. See, Jeremiah had a purpose. Jeremiah had a hope. And Jeremiah had a mighty God. You know, I want to proclaim something to you this morning. Not in my power, not based on my authority, but based on the authority of God's word. That God has a purpose for you. God has a purpose for this church. God has a purpose for the community of believers that live in our area. Our purpose is to know God. Our purpose is to bring him pleasure, to bring him honor and glory. Our purpose is to be a part of his family. Our purpose is to become like Christ and reflect him to this world. Our purpose is to do whatever God has uniquely shaped each and every one of us to do, to help redirect the eternity of men and women and boys and girls and lead people to the fullness of life that can only be found in Christ Jesus. I also proclaim to you this morning that we have a hope to anchor to. We have a God to run to. He is our safety net. He does fulfill his promises, and he will greatly encourage us if we will just trust him. Jesus has gone before us. He's prepared a way for us. And one day, let me tell you something, one day he is going to come back for us. I want to proclaim to you this morning that our God is a mighty God. He knows your struggle. He knows exactly where you're at in your life. And even if you're suffering this morning, it's only for a short term. Don't lose hope. Hang on to the anchor that you have in Jesus Christ. And I proclaim to you that our God is mighty. And he knows everything about you and is willing to be right beside you during this time. Now, I want to remind you of this. Paul, okay, when he was facing death, okay, I mean, he was about to be killed. He writes to Timothy and he says this, "I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him." There's a great song out there. It's called, Rachel Platten sings it, Fight Song. I love the chorus to that song, okay? "This is my fight song. My take back my life song, prove I'm all right song, my power's turned on, starting right now I'll be strong, I'll play my fight song, and I really don't care if anyone else believes, because I've still got a lot of fight left in me." Now, that's not a Christian song, but let me tell you something. That ought to be our song today, that no matter what happens, no matter what takes place in the days, in the weeks ahead, I'm not giving up. Not as long as I have breath, not as long as I have purpose and an anchor and a mighty God to serve. I know it can be tough, but hang on to Jesus. That's my prayer for you this morning. Father God, thank you for our time together. Thank you for the life of Jeremiah. Lord, I pray it's been an encouragement to us. God, I pray that we would look at his life and maybe realize that maybe we don't have it so bad. But then again, Father, I know that there are people in our community right now that are really, really suffering. Father, a good friend of mine has the virus. He's having a difficult time. And Father, I pray for him and I pray for his family. And right now that family is going through a whole lot of mess at this point. God, it's all around us. Our world's in chaos. But Lord, you're not done with us yet. Lord, we're still standing here breathing. You've still given us this place called the church to be your ambassadors for Jesus Christ. So God, as long as we're here, help us to see that mighty God that we serve. Encourage those, Father, that need to be encouraged. God, I love you and I praise you, and I pray that this is spoken to someone's heart. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, God bless you guys. Okay, I want to encourage you to come back for our final Greatest Hits next week, Volume 8, and I'll see you then. God bless you.